to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host on this Friday, August 21st, 2015. Got a lot of news today. We're going to be talking about technologies of control. We look at this situation with immigration, and I talked about the Donald Trump policy paper on immigration. I think it's a great policy paper, quite frankly. I've been very critical of Donald Trump because of his personal background and because of the lack of detail in his immigration policies. He's obviously riding a wave of anger about the inactivity of our government. And there's a reason that both the Republicans and the Democrats aren't doing anything about it. We're going to talk about that. His plan addresses some of those reasons, but it goes off in one tangent in a way that I don't agree with. We're going to take a look at his back and forth with Bill O'Reilly. Bill O'Reilly agreed with him partially and disagreed with him partially. I disagreed with Bill O'Reilly 100%. I agreed with Trump partially and disagreed with him partially. The thing that concerns me is the thing that I see 90% nearly of American citizens supporting, and that is a giant wall. We're going to talk about what that looks like. The best place to understand what that looks like and what that is going to be, it's not going to be the kind of medieval wall that they built in China. That, of course, is going to be totally ineffective. You're not going to build a wall that's high enough or deep enough that's going to keep people out. They'll find a way in if you incentivize it. That's what we're talking about. But we're going to talk about how his plan removes some of the incentives. We're going to talk about some of the legal aspects because there's been a lot of back and forth about the term anchor baby. I think everybody enjoyed seeing Donald Trump push back on the politically correct questioner from the reporter telling him that what he wanted it to be termed. He says, I'll just use the term anchor baby. We're going to take a look at Hillary Clinton pushing back against the anchor baby, the hypocrisy of that. We're going to look at some more information about her emails. It turns out that some of these emails were born classified. That's right. They're the kinds of discussions going back and forth that were classified from the very beginning. People in the State Department know that if you're talking to someone who is a foreign head of state, those discussions are to be kept classified, period. But we're also going to take a close look at the post facto classification. They're saying, well, these were not classified when she put them on her private server. They were classified later. You know, we're going to talk to someone who was prosecuted for doing that very thing, having documents that were later classified. Thomas Drake, he's one of the whistleblowers from the NSA. We're not going to talk to him today, but we're going to talk to him on the Sunday show. So I want everyone to tune in on the Sunday show because his is a very important case. Like William Binney, he was one of the very important NSA whistleblowers. But unlike William Binney or the other NSA whistleblowers, they came after Thomas Drake in persecution, I would say, not a prosecution. But the means that they came after him was to say that he had documents that had been classified. They were not classified when he took them. They were not the kinds of documents like Hillary Clinton's documents that were, let's say, born classified. And that's not my term. That's the term of someone who actually does the classification. Worked for the government throughout the Bush and Clinton administrations. He knows what he's talking about. So in Thomas Drake's situation, he not only can talk to us about the dangers of a surveillance state, as William Binney can, but he can also talk to us about the hypocrisy of what is going on now. They went through everything to try to prosecute him. Now they're going in every way they can to excuse what Hillary Clinton is doing. We're also going to be talking when we come back about economic news. Global stocks are falling yet again on concerns about China. And the situation in Greece continues on. The prime minister has stepped down. They're going to have yet another referendum trying to get the people to tell them, as if he didn't already know, that they don't want a bailout for the banks. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We're going to be joined in the third hour by John Rappaport. And we've got a lot of news about immigration, of course, because this has been the thing that's really been fueling Donald Trump's run for the presidency. He's put out a detailed statement, and now people are talking about it. It basically breaks down into three different areas. He addresses some of the incentives for businesses to bring workers in. Part of that is the H-1B visa program. We're going to talk about that. I think he's absolutely right about that. It's good that he is bringing that in as part of the discussion. He also talks about anchor babies. I think he's absolutely right about that. We're going to talk about the back and forth that's going on, not only with the PC term, people saying we don't want you using the term anchor baby, just like they don't want people using the term illegal alien. We're going to talk about that, but also we're going to talk about the wall. And of course, that seems to be the most popular aspect of his policy and the one that I disagree with the most. And let me tell you why. This is something that is a technology of population control. As I mentioned in the last segment, this is not going to be some kind of a medieval wall like the Chinese built, the Great Wall of China. That was built to keep out armies. But you're not going to keep people out one at a time if you incentivize them coming in, give them massive economic incentives. And of course, those incentives are coming not only from big business, but they're coming from big government. The socialist welfare state is incentivizing this, of course. We see this happening by executive order. So there's a lot that could be done with executive order, which I didn't see on Donald Trump's plan, just in ending this deferred, the DACA plan, the Dreamer plan, not sending people back up to the age of 31. So there's a lot that could be done in terms of just undoing the executive orders, just enforcing the law as it stands. But of course, the thing that people are supporting, and this is, it has massive support, 70% of the people support a wall. Only 17% don't support that. So, you know, you've got about 80 to 90% of the people who want to have a wall at the border. You even have Bill O'Reilly talking to Donald Trump and saying, well, that's great because that could even help with our drug problem. What utter nonsense. Certainly, you understand that we haven't been able to stop drug use after 40-plus years of the war on drugs. And it doesn't stop it to even put people in prison. You can't stop the flow of drugs into a prison. So are we going to turn the United States into a prison? Let me tell you how that looks. And we're going to talk about that later in the show. We're going to talk about the technologies of control, in particular, the system that Hewlett-Packard, starting under Carly Fiorina, enacted in Israel to keep control of Palestinians. And of course, it's not just Palestinians, but it's Israeli citizens who get the ID card as well. There's going to be consequences for everyone, not just those people who are the Ausländer, the outsider, the foreigner, okay? It's going to be for everybody. But take a look at what's going on. This is what we have to be careful of is the divide and conquer strategy. We have to be careful that this isn't going to lead to a race war with our rhetoric or with our policies. And of course, that's exactly what is happening with the Black Lives Matter. We pointed out many times that George Soros' organization is funding the leadership of Black Lives Matter. He's not giving money to all these other people. They're feeding off of their frustration. We have an article up on Infowars.com. Black Lives Matter mob invades Central West End, busts out car lights, beats pedestrians. Here's a clip of that, what that sounds like, what it looks like.
We're ready for war!
Yeah!
We're ready for war!
Yeah!
We're ready for war!
Yeah!
I got ready for war!
Yeah!
We're ready for war!
Yeah!
We're ready for war, that's what they're saying.
Yeah!
If you're ready, you're ready for war!
Yeah!
I repeat after me.
We're
ready for war!
Yeah!
So
make no mistake about it, that is really the purpose of the Black Lives Matter, what the Soros organization is pushing. They want to push a divide and conquer. They want to push a race war. We need to be very careful about that. The reason that they're doing this is because of the economic situation that everybody is concerned about. So let's talk about the economic news. That's why they're getting everything prepared for war abroad as well as war within. It's to distract people when everything hits the fan. Global stocks are falling farther on Chinese worries. They say a global stock rout intensified today on Friday on fresh worries about China's economy. This is from the Wall Street Journal. They say signs of a sharp slowdown in the world's second largest economy have unnerved investors since Beijing surprised markets last week by devaluing its currency. On Friday, an early gauge of China's factory activity fell to a 6.5-year low, keeping further pressure on stocks and commodities after Thursday's sell-off. They said it becomes ever more evident that China's economy is cooling off. Well, It's not that China's economy is cooling off. China's economy has been on fire because they've been taking all of the jobs and manufacturing from the rest of the world. They cannot sustain a 10% growth rate while the U.S. and the West are flat or negative, or perhaps in the best of times, a 1% growth rate. That cannot go on indefinitely. When they look at what's going on with oil, and they're talking about how oil is taking it down and the markets are taking it out, I don't think those are the sources of it. They're reflecting a weak economy that is global. When the Saudis can just maintain production level and you can see a massive plunge in the price of oil, that says that it's a demand problem. It's a problem all across the globe. They say with China's economy slowing and oil prices on track for their longest losing streak since 1986, there's fears that the global market's on the verge of a major turndown. No, of course they are. It's not just the stock markets. It's the entire world economy. That is why there is so much effort put into this divide and conquer strategy. Trying to create a race war here, trying to balkanize the United States with massive immigration. At the same time, they know that they can get reliable voters bringing people in and incentivizing that. And so the biggest thing we could do is to stop incentivizing massive immigration on the government side. And we need to put fees in on the business side. We need to raise the price of wages for people who are coming in with the H-1B visa program. That's one of the things that Donald Trump talked about that was absolutely right. And of course, people have pointed out in articles that Donald Trump himself, his companies took advantage of the H-1B visa program, thousands of workers coming in. One of the most famous examples of that and the abuse of that was Disney recently, where they, in service jobs, brought in a bunch of workers from India, told the American workers who were there to train their replacements, and they were fired because they could bring the Indian workers in at a fraction of what they were paying the American workers. Now, the H-1B visa program was set up ostensibly to bring in foreign workers who had specialized skills, primarily technology. And you see a lot of this happening in Silicon Valley. We'll talk about that later when we get back to the immigration stuff. I don't want to get off on the immigration. I kind of got onto that a little bit with the H-1B visa program, but it allows them to bring people in and pay them a fraction. Even in Silicon Valley, they're not bringing in people that have special skills that they can't find elsewhere. They're bringing in tech workers and paying them about two-thirds of what they're paying the workers there. Typical workers that are getting in the 90,000 level pay rate, they're bringing in foreign workers and paying them about 60,000. That's the reason they're bringing it in. So Donald Trump's solution is very simple. Just say that with the H-1B visa program, you're not going to be allowed to bring people in unless you pay them the same wage. That removes the incentive. That's what we need to be doing all over the place. We do not need to create a massive police state. We don't need to create another army of policemen in ICE, just as we've done elsewhere. We've already tripled the number of ICE agents after September 11th. We don't need to triple them again. So I disagree with that aspect of it. I disagree with the wall. And as I said, we'll talk about that in a bit. But we need to do things to disincentivize people coming in. And that's something that could be done a lot by a president. Again, getting back to economic news, I wanted to talk about Greece because Greece is still in the news. The prime minister quit yesterday, called an early poll. They say he was elected, of course, only in January. Now he has resigned so they can have an election. He's essentially making this a referendum on a third bailout. They already had a referendum on the first bailout, and every one of these bailouts has gone up exponentially in price to the Greek people. And the first bailout, they said no. So what is it about no you don't understand? He keeps coming back hoping that he's going to get some kind of a stamp of approval. I don't see that happening. Nevertheless, there are rebels within his party. They say that they're going to essentially push him out, maybe like we hope can happen with Boehner. And when I look at this, turmoil in Greece about the Syriza rebels forming a new party, and of course, that's the party of the current prime minister, I think about whether or not we have an opportunity to do that here in America with this election. Perhaps that is more important than the presidential race, because we have a Republican Party that has a leadership that has thoroughly sold out. They are indistinguishable from the Democrat Party. Would it be possible, you think, that we could, at the primary level, because once you get to the general election, it's going to be far too late. At the primary level, could we get rid of some of these rhinos in the Republican Party, the big government status? Could we have some new, fresh candidates who would come in and essentially have a revolution? Because quite frankly, no matter who you elect as president, unless you change the makeup of Congress and get some people in there who are not only willing to do something, but to do the right thing, because the Congress we have now has just abdicated all of its authority to the president, to the courts, to anyone. They don't do anything to the globalists who are writing the trade treaties. They don't do anything. At the primary level, we have a chance to have a revolution like they're trying to do in Greece. Can we get the deadwood out of our country? We'll see. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We're going to take a look at the anchor babies and the wall. We'll be right back. We're going to be joined in the third hour with John Rappaport. As I mentioned at the top of the show on Sunday, we're going to have Thomas Drake join us. He's one of the NSA whistleblowers who, along with William Binney, resigned after they realized that the government was doing dragnet surveillance unconstitutionally. Unlike the other NSA whistleblowers, Thomas Drake was actually charged. They tried to put him in jail. They came after him with prosecutions for having documents that had been were not classified at the time he took them. They were classified later. Does that sound familiar? That's precisely the defense of Hillary Clinton, and yet they actually have had situations where they prosecuted people. I would say it was persecution. So we're going to talk to him about what the NSA is doing, why he resigned. We're also going to talk about how differently he was treated than Hillary Clinton. A very important story. That's going to be on Sunday. Later today, John Rappaport will be joining us. I wanted to get to the immigration stories here because there's been a lot of back and forth about the anchor baby issues. And before I get to that, I want to let you know that we have a sale today on Silver Bullet. For a limited time only, you can get 30% off of one Silver Bullet, or you can get two and buy two and get two free. Silver Bullet is our powerful colloidal silver product that is both free of artificial additives, is perfect for your preparedness supply. It's concentrated to 30 parts per million in a pure base of deionized water. There's a reason listeners have dubbed Silver Bullet as their preparedness silver. So right now at InfoWarsLife.com, you can get one bottle for 30% off, or you can buy two and get two free. That's 50% off. That's for a limited time only, and you'll find that at InfoWarsLife.com. Now I want to play a clip of this reporter who was coming after Donald Trump over his use of the term anchor baby. And of course, one of the things that is making Donald Trump so popular is he's not playing the political correctness game. And certainly, I applaud that. Let's play this clip.
Where did the term anchor baby? That's an offensive term. People find that.
You mean it's not politically correct and yet everybody uses it? So you know what? Give me a different term. What else would you like to say?
The American-born child of an undocumented immigrant.
Oh, you want me to say that? Okay. No, I'll use the word anchor baby. Excuse me. I'll use the word anchor baby.
He gives this long phrase he wants them to use. He says, no, I'll just use the term anchor baby. Well, Jeb Bush got called on that as well. And, you know, this is reported from Politico. They say that Jeb Bush doesn't want birthright citizenship to go away, but he is calling for stronger enforcement for people who use it, who abuse it, should say. In other words, Jeb Bush isn't going to build a wall. He's going to sit on a fence when it comes to immigration. That's the bottom line with Jeb Bush. But then it got even better because Hillary Clinton called out Jeb Bush on using the term anchor baby. I guess she knows better than to call out Donald Trump. So Twitter users called out Hillary Clinton and they said, how about calling it a clump of anchor cells? Because Hillary Clinton has undying support for Planned Parenthood, no matter how horrific these videos get. And of course, we just had the latest video that showed a child that was moving on the operating table, and that is the consequence of this, moving the arm, moving their leg, and beating heart. And this is what Hillary Clinton cannot find her find any way to criticize this. She would just basically call it a clump of sales. So yeah, you're going to talk about babies. Let's talk about maybe we should call them a clump of anchor cells. Well, of course, the left is pushing back, and even people on the right are pushing back. He went on to the O'Reilly show, Donald Trump did, to talk about his program. And let's play the one about the 14th Amendment first, guys. I said we'd play the other one first. Let's play the one about the 14th Amendment, because Bill O'Reilly says that he knows what's in the 14th Amendment. Now, neither he nor Donald Trump actually talked about what the 14th Amendment says. But this is what Bill O'Reilly had to say about the 14th Amendment and about removing anchor babies.
Bill, I think you're wrong about the 14th Amendment. And frankly, the whole thing with anchor babies and the concept of anchor babies, I don't think you're right about that.
I
think
can it's quote going it. To be you want me to quote you the amendment? If you're born here, you're an American. Period. Period.
But there are many lawyers are saying that's not the way it is.
Yeah, he's saying if you're born here, you're a citizen. Period. Period. No, actually, if you read it, it's a comma. It's a qualifying phrase there. Subject to their jurisdiction. Stay with us when we come back. I'll explain what that means. We're going to be joined in the third hour with John Rappaport. I want to go back and talk a bit more about Donald Trump's immigration program, because I think there's a lot that's good in it. There's some that I think is wrong with it, and we'll talk about both of those aspects. But as far as anchor babies go, I think what he has to say about this is something that we need to talk about publicly. We need to have this national discussion about one of the incentives, one of the things that we've come to accept in as being laws, being constitutional, that I don't really believe is constitutional. And I'll tell you why. First of all, the abuse. And Donald Trump pointed this out when he talked to Bill O'Reilly. There's an article on Breitbart, says an immigration attorney says that anchor babies are now big money business in the United States, $99,000 per sale. So these immigration attorneys are getting people to come over. They're working with people in China and other countries. This isn't something that is just coming in from Central America, but they're having people coming in from China who are willing to pay $99,000 to have their baby in the United States, foreign parents who are not citizens. Then they use that child to get themselves into the country. Now, there's an article pushing back against this whole idea. They say anchor babies are a myth. This is an article from Forbes magazine back in 2014. There's a lot of pushback, understand, from both the left and the right, because both the left and the right, the leadership of both the left and the right, want open borders. You have to understand that. So we're seeing this kind of pushback from both of those sectors. Now, what they say in this article on Forbes back in 2014, they say you may not be aware that the mere birth of a child in North America does not guarantee the child nor the parents the right to live in the United States or Canada, at least not until the child reaches the age of majority. Put another way, the family can be and often is removed from the U.S. or Canada even if they have a native-born child because they do not have lawful status in the country. Well, that's why Obama enacted the Dreamer Act, the DACA Act. That's something that a president could easily remove because that's his executive order. That's his policy. That is not the law. But that's precisely why they extended that to children up to the age of 31. Children up to the age of 31. Let that sink in. Now, they say once a child reaches the age of 21, in the case of the United States, 18 in the case of Canada, that child can return to North America and sponsor their parents to legally immigrate into the country. That's why we talk about it being an anchor baby situation. That's why the parents are willing to pay an immigration attorney $99,000 to do that, because then they can come here and they can live in America as citizens. They can also get onto the welfare state rolls, because we do not have any conditions that people need to be able to support themselves before they come here. And of course, that's in Donald Trump's immigration policy as well. I think it's very important for us to look at these policies. Donald Trump has a very detailed immigration policy. Scott Walker has a very detailed policy about how he would change Obamacare. A lot of very good articles. I don't support Donald Trump or Scott Walker. I don't trust Donald Trump personally. And you have to trust that somebody is actually going to do what they say. And because of his past and because of other issues, I personally don't trust him. But I think it's important to have these policy issues. That's why I think it's very important for Rand Paul to be in. Rand Paul is the only candidate who is talking about civil liberties, about dragnet surveillance. I think it's important for us to look at real policies, to have candidates who are talking about issues that other candidates won't talk about, offering detailed solutions that other candidates are not offering. So it's important for us to take a look at the immigration policies of Donald Trump. What's right with it? What's wrong with it? Now, The Guardian also pushes back and says this is a history of futile conservative attempts to repeal the law. And this is what they say. They say that because of nativist angst, supporters of the 14th Amendment measure expressly argued that it would apply to children of immigrants, and the amendment was ultimately enacted in 1868. Now, think about that. They say people were concerned about this. There was nativist angst. In other words, people were xenophobic. They didn't want foreigners to come in. They say the targets were mostly at the time Chinese or Roma immigrants. And so they passed an amendment that would make this come in. No, exactly the opposite of that. When they passed this amendment because of that nativist angst, they explicitly said that the 14th Amendment did not make children born here of foreign parents citizens. They expressly pointed that out. Let's take a look at the history of the 14th Amendment. Because at the time that it came out, there was also a Civil Rights Act of 1866. Now, understand that the 13th, the 14th, and the 15th Amendment were not there to discuss issues of citizenship primarily. These were all there to address the issue of the newly freed slaves. First of all, the 13th Amendment freed the slaves. It wasn't Lincoln's Emancipation Proclamation. That was done, I think, in 1863. The 13th Amendment was passed after the war. There were still slaves in many of the northern and border territories after the war. The Emancipation Proclamation said that slaves in the areas in rebellion were freed, but it didn't free the slaves in Missouri, for example, where Ulysses Grant, the general of the Union Army, still had slaves that were held by his family. Those were not freed until later. The 13th Amendment freed the slaves. The 14th Amendment gave them civil rights, and the 15th Amendment gave them voting rights. Now, when they passed the Civil Rights Act of 1866, at first the president refused to sign it. Then they came back, they overrode his veto. Still, others argued that Congress didn't have constitutional power to enact the 14th Amendment or to give civil rights to the newly freed slaves. That's why they passed the 14th Amendment, so that they could have these civil rights. And they made it very clear when they talked about it. They said, well, I know you're concerned that the newly freed slaves are going to be voting. Don't worry. That's not going to happen. Voting is going to be determined on a state-by-state level. That also doesn't mean that they're going to sit on juries. It also doesn't mean that their kids are going to be able to go to school. That's what they said at the time. That's why they did a 15th Amendment later. You understand how this incrementally ran out, how they applied this gradually through these different processes. That's why we have three different amendments all done at about the same time. But if we look at the Civil Rights Act of 1866, we see a summary there. This is of the fellow who introduced the bill in the House of Representatives, a congressman. It was written by a senator, Lyman Trumbull, and James F. Wilson introduced it into the House of Representatives. And he says it provides for the equality of citizens of the United States in the enjoyment of civil rights and immunities. It used very similar language to the 14th Amendment in terms of talking about citizenship. But the Civil Rights Act of 1866 said that in addition to being born on U.S. soil, the children could not be subject to any foreign power. In other words, they could not be the subjects of another country. That's what that means. That means they could not be citizens of another country. And so when they put it in the 14th Amendment, they turned it around the other way. They said, if the parents are subject to the jurisdiction of the states, in other words, if they are Americans. And when Bill O'Reilly says, that's what it says, period, he's not looking at the actual text because there's a comma there. It says people born in the United States are citizens, comma, subject if they're subject to their jurisdiction of the states. It's essentially the same thing the Parallel Act of 1866 said, that they had to be not subjects of a foreign country. The 14th Amendment then said they have to be, their parents have to be citizens of one of the United States. You understand that these two things were written at the same time. We have comments from the senators, from the congressmen who wrote this. We can see this from the two parallel acts, that the intention was clearly to give citizenship to the newly freed slaves and not to allow foreigners to have to become citizens, when to have their children become citizens if they were born in this country. That's precisely what it was meant to do. Then the Supreme Court enters. In 1898, there was a Supreme Court decision, United States versus Wong Kim Ark. Now, this was a man who, after he grew up, he came back and wanted to enter the country. And there were immigration controls for people from China at that time. But he said, I was born here in the United States. And they said, yes, but your parents were foreigners. They took it all the way to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court gave us the interpretation that is now being used to create this anchor baby situation. And we have to ask, are we going to allow the Supreme Court to have the final say on everything? That is the fundamental issue that we need to address, because we're seeing over and over again, especially in the recent Supreme Court decisions, they're not arguing the points of law even. They see themselves as representatives of public opinion. No, that's what the House of Representatives are for. That's what the senators are for. That's not the purpose of the Supreme Court. The senators were actually supposed to represent the sensitivities of the state, but that changed with a constitutional amendment. We have elected representatives who are supposed to represent the wishes of the people with their laws. The Supreme Court is supposed to look at the intention and the wording of the Constitution and make their rulings, but we see instead that what they're doing is ruling on the wishes of the people, and our elected representatives are just sitting there passively doing nothing. Let's go on to this next clip here where Donald Trump and Bill O'Reilly were talking about Donald Trump's immigration policy. Guys, let's do the one about the wall, because O'Reilly really loves the wall. And I want to talk about the consequences of that, because he's not the only one who really loves the wall. Donald Trump wants to put a wall in. He says, of course, the Chinese did it. They did it a couple of thousand years ago, so we can build an even better wall than the Chinese did. Yeah, we can. We've got much better technology. We can build a total population control grid using biometrics, using the latest technology. And we're going to talk about what that looks like, and we're going to talk about the dangers of what that looks like. Something like that is already in use. We could call it a beta test for America. It's being done in Israel, and we're going to talk about what that looks like. In the case, the particular case, interestingly enough, it's done by Hewlett-Packard. It began while Carly Fiorina was CEO at Hewlett-Packard. We're going to talk about what those biometric controls look like. But of course, the survey from Rasmussen says that 70% of likely Republican voters agree with Donald Trump to build the wall. They say that 17% of voters disagree, 13% are undecided. So you've got only 17% who disagree with this, who think this is not a good idea. One of the people, however, who agrees with Donald Trump, who thinks it's a great idea, of course, is Bill O'Reilly. Let's play that clip now.
The strongest part of your immigration plan, in my opinion, is the wall. I think it's a doable thing. Rudy Giuliani came in here, and you can do it. And that would cut down a lot of the illegal immigration, and not only that, the drug trafficking, which is out of control. So I support the wall.
Okay, so it's going to cut down drug trafficking, right? And as I pointed out earlier in the show, if you can't keep drugs out of prisons, and they have so many drugs in prison that you have hundreds of drug overdose deaths a year in federal prison, force is not going to work with immigration any more than it has worked with the war on drugs. Tripling the number of ICE agents, giving people ID cards, building a wall, none of that is going to stop it as long as the incentives are there. As long as business is drawing in cheap labor, as long as the government is bringing people in for its socialist control agenda. What we're going to wind up with, if we do this, we really will literally create a prison state. And I want you to take a look at this report. This is something from an organization, Who Profits. And they're looking at the technologies of control, in particular, the case of Hewlett-Packard. Now, Hewlett-Packard has put in place in Israel, in the occupied territories, and on the West Bank areas, they have put in biometric monitoring equipment. They have a system that is called the Basel system, B-A-S-E-L. It was something that was originally developed by Ross Perot's company long after Ross Perot left, EDS Israel. They're now an HP company. They're the prime contractor of this. It's automated biometric access control system. It's installed and maintained by Hewlett-Packard at checkpoints throughout the occupied territories. Now, what you have with this is a magnetic card with biometric information about you. Since 2005, it has been mandatory for every Palestinian who requests a permit to enter Israel. And let's talk about what this looks like when they come into this area here. There's a description of the process that they go through. And let me ask you, if you would like to live like this, because understand that it is not only the Palestinians who are getting national ID cards, it's also the Israelis who have national ID cards. Of course, they're not going through as much of the inspections as the Palestinians are. They say the checkpoints now have been undergoing a process of privatization because they look too militarized. So they want it to look a little bit more friendly. So it aims to turn the newly constructed checkpoints into terminals that look like international borders. In other words, it looks like TSA. How would you like to have TSA everywhere? You want to triple the number of ICE agents? Do you realize how many times ICE agents are engaging people hundreds of miles from the border? Up to 100 miles, they say, is open territory. So they set up checkpoints, they set up roadblocks, and they ask you for your ID. Now, they say, by modernizing the checkpoints in Israel and relying heavily on technology, Israel hopes to project a humanized image of its treatment of Palestinians. So let's talk about the process. The process is carried out in corridors containing small rooms whose walls are made of unidirectional glass. A security officer stands behind the glass and calls the examinee into the first room over a microphone. After the examinees are told to leave the personal belongings in the first room, they leave the room, the door is locked behind them, and the security officers appear and then go through your personal things. Once he's left, the examinees are then again called over the microphone, move on to the next room in the corridor, where they're then told to drop their magnetic cards into a bowl, pass it through a small window to a computerized screening station. At that point, they put the card in and they look at the biometric identifiers on there in order to examine their face, their fingerprints, and anything else that they can take a look at. This is not what we want to have happen in the United States. Of course, this is. Let's talk about the walls, the separation wall. They say 85% of the walls are behind the West Bank. However, it includes not only a watchtower, but a buffer zone, electric fences, sensors, surveillance cameras. This is what you're talking about when you're talking about setting up a wall at the border. You're talking about turning America into a prison state. You're talking about turning the Western United States into the West Bank. You need to think about this because we've got Republicans. All Republicans running for president, essentially, except I think for Rand Paul, are supporting a wall. Maybe he even supports it. I'm not sure. I haven't heard him say. We have to get past this. We have to not support this. 70% of the Republicans support this. Right now, stay with us. John Rappaport is going to be joining us in the third hour. We've been talking about Donald Trump's immigration policy. There's much to like about it. One of the things that I don't like about it seems to be the thing that is most popular with GOP voters, and that is the wall that he would build. I'm trying to make the case to the GOP voters, to the people who think that you can come up with a simple solution like this, that it is going to have incredibly bad consequences for our freedom. I agree with the policies that Donald Trump has that would remove financial incentives for businesses to bring people in, essentially revising the H-1B program, the visa program, that would mean that they can bring foreign workers in if they can't find somebody that has those particular skills, but they're going to have to pay them the prevailing rate. They're not going to be able to use it to pay people two-thirds of what they pay American workers, and that's the way that it's been abused right now. That's a good thing. We also need to talk about the anchor baby situation, about the whole idea of birthright citizenship. foreign parents coming to this country, not becoming American citizens, having a child here, and then coming back at a later date to live in America. We need to talk about that anchor baby situation. We talked about the history of that and how I don't believe that there's a strong legal case in spite of the Supreme Court decision. We've seen this over and over again. Of course, we had a Supreme Court decision that said that abortion was a right of privacy. They invented that right of privacy, and they ignore our Fourth Amendment protections that are being violated all the time by our government. I mean, it's absolutely absurd. And of course, Hillary Clinton calls Jeb Bush on using the term anchor baby and says, it's a baby, to which there was a storm of Twitter replies saying, maybe you should call it a clump of anchor cells, because Hillary Clinton supports Planned Parenthood without exception in what they're doing. Before we get back to looking at the wall and some of the consequences for this and how it's going to be used, I want to let you know that we have Survival Shield X2 back in stock. This hour of the Alex Jones Show is made possible by your support of the high-quality products that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com, products like Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine. We have over 400 reviews at InfoWarsLife.com. Over 99% of the people there would recommend it to friends and to families. Let me read you one of those reviews of Survival Shield X2. This is from Kat in Ohio. Says, there's nothing at all like this, according to my doctor. He's going to get him some as well. He was so impressed at how it made him feel, and just so much better the old way. They say he was impressed by it. They wanted to give me double what I paid for it so he could have it now. I kept my bottle and showed him how to order. He and I are so grateful that Alex Jones goes out of his way to make sure the quality of all he is selling. You can see a lot of these reviews. You can take a look at what people say that it has done for them, different conditions that they say that it has helped them with. But take a look at it. See if it is something that is right for you. Of course, we all know that our body needs iodine, and we don't see it supplemented in many of our foods now. That's been removed. So this is a way that you can supplement it with a very, very high quality source, the highest quality iodine that you can find. You can get that at InfoWarsLife.com. That's Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine. Now, going back to this report, and as I pointed out, if we build a wall, it's not going to look like the Great Wall of China necessarily. A wall like that is not going to work. As long as you've got incentives, of course, people are going to come in one at a time. What we're looking at is we're going to eventually get to a situation where we have high-tech electronic control, technologies of control. We've talked many times about autonomous self-driving cars. That's something we should all be very concerned about. That is a major technology of control. We're moving forward with that. But there's also an opportunity for them to use these technologies of control to say that we have to vet to see whether or not you are an American citizen. Of course, part of Donald Trump's program would say that he's going to rely more on E-Verify. Most of the Republicans like that. That is a horrible idea. That makes everyone subject to the approval of Homeland Security in order to get a job. When we come back, I'm going to tell you about a personal experience of someone I knew who lost their job because they didn't E-Verify. And they've been here with their family for many generations. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host today. We've been talking about the immigration policies that have been put forth by Donald Trump. He's done us all a favor and put out a very detailed immigration program, and I applaud him for doing that. As I mentioned before, Scott Walker has done the same thing with Obamacare. Many of the candidates have got websites, and of course, Trump's was like this as well, where all you see is information about the candidate and an opportunity to get on their mailing list and donate money to them and buy some of their swag. But Donald Trump has put up a detailed policy proposal now about immigration, and Scott Walker has done the same thing on Obamacare. Those are the only two proposals that either of them have up. Some of the candidates have put up a lot of different issues, but tackled it from a very shallow standpoint. I like to see the deeper policies that are put up there in these two by Walker and by Trump, because it lets us look at the actual meat of the program. It is interesting to see the policies that people want to talk about, some of the issues. Of course, Rand Paul has a lot of issues up on his site. He doesn't go into nearly as much detail, but he brings up issues that other people are not talking about. Dragnet surveillance, civil liberties, asset forfeiture. We know from the legislation that Rand Paul has put out what he would do about these. He's spoken about these things in depth and at length, even though he doesn't have it up on his website. And we can see what he would do to overturn abuses and corruption of our legal system, like we see with civil asset forfeiture. Scott Walker talks about Obamacare. One of the things he points out is that, in an example, a lady, let's take an average a lady who's single, 35 years old, and making about $35,000, she doesn't get any subsidies from Obamacare. But under his plan, what he would do is give tax credits. I believe in that particular case, it was about $2,100 in tax credits for that particular individual. That would actually help with insurance. So what Obama has given us is not anything that really helps us as individuals. What it does is it helps the insurance companies. We pointed out from the beginning that the insurance companies were the ones who are benefiting from Obamacare. They were the ones who put this legislation through, both for RomneyCare, Massachusetts, and then Obamacare that was patterned after it. They made sure that regardless of who got elected, they were going to get their crony capitalist hooks into us. They were going to force us to buy insurance at rates that we couldn't afford for coverage that we didn't want or need. But if you really want to help people with something, you'll give them not only a tax deduction, you'll give them a tax credit. We all know when we fill out our income tax forms, many times I've had situations where we had a lot of medical expenses in a particular year. We thought, well, maybe we'll get a deduction. No, you have to exceed a large percentage of your adjusted gross income before you can even deduct the first dollar. And of course, those are deductions. They're not tax credits. So you don't get a dollar for dollar savings, obviously. But what Walker's program would do would actually allow you to take the money that you spend for your health insurance, for your health care, things like medical savings accounts that people have proposed in the past. This would allow you to pay for your health care before you pay the IRS. Wouldn't that be a great idea? Isn't that something, if they really cared about our health care, wouldn't they say, all right, we understand that your health care is so important that you can take care of that before you send the money to Washington? No, they don't. They don't really care about your health. They won't give you even a reasonable deduction, let alone a tax credit. So I think he has some excellent ideas in his proposal. He talks about how he could actually make healthcare more affordable for people. And that's precisely what we're seeing in some of the proposals from Donald Trump. But as I said before, one of the things that concerns me the most is this idea, the very, very popular idea, that we can solve the open borders by closing them off like a prison, like a Berlin Wall. We need to reject that idea. And when we come back, I'm going to give you one more reason. Then we're going to move on. We're going to talk about Hillary Clinton's email. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We're going to be joined in the third hour with John Rappaport. We're going to talk, among other things, of course, we're going to talk about the vaccine issue, what a congressman did before they went on break. Talking about the CDC documents, looking at the effects of vaccines. We're also going to talk about how people are being divided amongst each other. And of course, one of the reasons that is happening is because of the unrest that we're seeing throughout the world. It's not just the economic unrest, but this headline today, North Korea says we're in a quasi-state of war. North Korea's leader Kim Jong-un on Friday said his country was in a quasi-state of war with South Korea, ordered his military to prepare for battle. Now, we could just dismiss this as the usual kind of saber rattling that we see from the North Korean leader, but it's also being responded to by the South Koreans as well. They have also upped the ante. They said this time it's going to be different if something happens. So that's something to be concerned about, as well as markets taking another big dive today because of new information out of China showing that their manufacturing index, future activity, took a major plunge. It's a very deep plunge. So it looks like things are slowing down for China. And of course, they're going to slow down for China. China is exporting. That's the basis of their growth. And when nobody is buying, that's going to cause an economic slowdown for China. So it's not that China is causing the slowdown worldwide. It's just that we're now seeing the signs in China of a global slowdown. That's what everyone is concerned about. That's why there's been so many warnings and concerns about what's going to happen this fall. Before I get back to the news, I do want to cover, before we go into any more in-depth analysis of the wall situation, I want to cover a few articles that are breaking news today. But before I do, I want to let you know that we have a sale going for a limited time only. You can get 30% off of Silver Bullet. That's in a single quality. If you buy two Silver Bullet, you can get two for free. So that'd be 50% off if you get two. One, you can get 30% off. Two, you can get 50% off because you'll get two more for free. Silver Bullet is our colloidal silver product, free of artificial additives. It's 30 parts per million in a base of pure deionized water. We also have available Prostagard. That is now in stock. It uses plant-based nutrients and antioxidants to naturally support your prostate. Our advanced formula contains a hand-selected blend of saw palmetto, lycopene, plant sterols, zinc, vitamin D3, selenium, and copper. It's something I take every day. My research says it's something that men, especially as you get older, should be adding to their daily routine. Again, you can get Prostagard at InfoWarsLife.com as well as our sale on Silver Bullet. Buy one at 30% off. If you get two, you'll get an additional two for free. It's a great way to stock up on your preparedness supplies. Now, while we're talking about health, there is a story. You heard Joe Biggs going over the headlines on the commercial break. There's a story up on InfoWars.com. Marijuana kills cancer. This is admitted to now by the National Cancer Institute. This is not news to most people, but it is news that the National Cancer Institute is finally admitting it. On their FAQ page, frequently asked questions, they say that cannabis, quote, may inhibit tumor growth by causing cell death, blocking cell growth, and blocking the development of blood vessels needed by tumors to grow. That has always been one of the major ways they have tried to attack tumor growth, and that is by anti-angiogenesis. That's the creating of blood cells, because tumors need to create blood cells very quickly. They say a lab study of CBD in estrogen receptor positive and estrogen receptor negative breast cell cancer cells showed that it caused cancer cell death while having little effect on normal breast cells. Studies in mouse models of metastatic, that means it's spread everywhere, breast cancer showed that the cannabinoids may lessen the growth, number, and the spread of tumors. Yes, folks, it's also safe. It's not only effective, but it is safe. Now you know why it's been illegal for so long. Because it works so much better than the dangerous drugs that are given to us by the pharmaceuticals. Now, there's an article that's up on InfoWars Underground Insider. I saw this in my email. This is something, if you don't subscribe to it, we offer this for free. It's a unique content that you don't see on the website, typically. And this particular article is, why punish people for speeding? This is something that I have asked myself many times. Every time I get a speeding ticket, it's like, why? And the point is, this is what the point of the article is, you haven't done anything to harm anybody. You haven't hit anyone. Why the ticket for speeding? And of course, we all know it's about revenue. What is the way to stop this kind of encroachment on us? When we get abused by the government, when we get things like speeding tickets, there's an excellent article that was up a couple of days ago on our site. We Are the Government: Tactics for Taking Down the Police State. This is from John Whitehead at the Rutherford Institute. I thought it was an excellent article because I've talked about it many times, and we can talk about the presidential candidacies, and it's good to talk about these policies. Like I was mentioning at the top of the hour, I was talking about Scott Walker's detailed policies to change Obamacare, to rewrite it into something that would actually help people, as opposed to forcing us to buy things that we don't want or don't need at a much higher price. Just like we're looking at the detailed policy of Donald Trump on immigration, it's great to have these detailed policies, to look at what's right about them, what's wrong about them, to have this kind of discussion. Nevertheless, real change is going to come at the local level. You need to understand that. We can't hammer that down enough. One of the main things we could do, as Alex Jones pointed out, is to get rid of John Boehner's. Call your congressman, whether you're a Democrat or a Republican, whether they're a Democrat or Republican, tell them to get John Boehner out. Vacate that seat. You know, we're really pretty close. There's only about five votes that would make the difference in getting him out. That's one of the reasons why they didn't immediately dismiss that. They were going to call that measure that was brought up by the North Carolina congressman, they were going to call that measure up for a vote right away, but they thought, well, let's call around first. And when they did, they found out that it was perilously close to him losing. So they tabled it and decided that they would wait until after their August break. I think it's about 5 weeks that they take off. So that gives them a chance to try to get these people on their side. This is when you need to be getting them on your side. This is something that everybody ought to be able to agree with. Democrats, of course, want to see him out of there. Republicans should want to see him out of there. He's an example of what's wrong with the whole process. Somebody who campaigns on issues and then shuts those down. We elected Republicans because we wanted to do something about the open borders, because we wanted to do something about Obamacare. Yet when anybody tries to bring up a measure about that in the Congress, they are shut down. And if they don't toe the Boehner line, they are punished. They're removed from subcommittees and they're relegated to irrelevance. So that's why we need to get involved with that. We need to get involved in the primaries. Make sure that we've got real candidates to vote for in the general election. Now is the time to get involved at the congressional level, at the state level, to get people in there. But there's other things that we can do that are extremely important. As he points out, this is John Whitehead from the Rutherford Institute, and this article we have on InfoWars.com. He said, the people have the power. All we have to do is awaken that the power is in the people. The people are unaware. They're not educated to realize that they have power. The system is so geared that everyone believes the government will fix everything. But we are the government. Guess who that quote's from? John Lennon. Yeah, absolutely. Now, John Whitehead says that various cities and states have been using the historic doctrine of nullification with mixed results on issues as wide-ranging as gun control and health care to claim freedom from federal laws they find to be onerous or wrongheaded. Great. But where nullifications can be particularly powerful, however, is in the hands of the juror. According to former federal prosecutor Paul Butler, the doctrine of jury nullification is, quote, premised on the idea that ordinary citizens, not government officials, should have the final say as to whether a person should be punished. That's the way we get our freedom back. We can shut down any law at the state level, at the local level, at the federal level, if we have jury trials and if we have informed jurors who know that their duty is to not just be referees, but to actually judge the law. We have inverted that in our courts. Now we have the judges who should have been referees essentially telling us that they're going to, we have to do exactly as they say, and we are relegated, if we follow their instructions, to just seeing if they follow the rules as they give them to us. No, we are the ones who are the government. We need to be actively involved. That's how we stop the abuses all the way down to traffic court. Fight it in court, ask for a jury trial. Of course, in Texas, it's pretty easy to do that. You just check that box off and you can go to a jury trial. But let's understand where this came from. I want to talk a little bit about the history of jury nullification. You probably heard of William Penn. He was the guy that Pennsylvania is named after. And of course, he came to America for religious freedom. The reason he left England was because the Quakers were not allowed to practice their religion there. They had a state religion that wasn't what the Quakers liked. And so to stop them from doing that, they passed a law. They actually said you cannot meet in these Quaker churches. Well, they ignored that law. They continued to meet. So they put chains on the doors of the churches. They still had their church service on the steps of the church. So then they arrested William Penn, and they took him to court. And when the jurors looked at it, they said, well, you know what? We don't agree with that law. We don't think that you should be able to tell people that they can't worship as they please. We don't believe that you should be able to lock William Penn up. So the foreman of the jury, when the jury delivered their verdict, they said, yeah, we understand what your law is, and we repudiate that. They locked up the foreman, Edward Bushnell. He was jailed for a very long period of time. The judge said, okay, you don't like the law, you're going to ignore the law, I'll lock you up for contempt or whatever. He didn't have a law. That case established habeas corpus. People said, what law did he violate? And they released him, establishing habeas corpus because there was no law against jury nullification. But most importantly, it established jury nullification. Stay with us when we come back. We're going to look more at Hillary Clinton's emails. It turns out they were classified from the start. We're going to be joined in the next hour by John Rappaport. We're going to talk about how the government is dividing and conquering the population, as well as cover-ups from a CDC whistleblower. A congressman pointed it out. It pretty much went unreported by most of the media. We reported it. We're going to talk about it in more detail when John Rappaport joins us. But, of course, we're also going to be talking on Sunday to Thomas Drake, one of the NSA whistleblowers, one of the ways that they came after him. And he was the only one of the NSA whistleblowers to be charged with anything. They charged him with having classified material that was classified long after he took it away. It was not classified when he took it. And of course, that's the alibi of Hillary Clinton. So it's going to be great. I want you to tune in on Sunday to hear Thomas Drake, because he's going to talk about the dangers of mass surveillance, as well as, like we've heard from William Binney, but he's also going to talk to us about how the government came after him for the same things that they are now refusing to come after Hillary Clinton for. It's interesting to see the Justice Department's reaction to someone who is a whistleblower versus someone who is like Hillary Clinton. And of course, it's not just the possession of the emails. We've been told that Ed Snowden is a traitor by many people, including people like Donald Trump, that he's a total traitor. We've been told that just having the emails is tantamount to giving it to other people, because he can't keep those emails secure. Therefore, any determined state actor can easily get to those emails. That's precisely what Hillary Clinton did. So why would we call Snowden a traitor and call Hillary Clinton a presidential candidate instead of coming after her to put her in jail? Now, it gets even worse. Today, we see from Reuters, dozens of Clinton emails were classified from the very beginning, suggest a U.S. ruling. They say while the department is now stamping a few dozen of the publicly released emails as classified, it stresses that this is not evidence of rule breaking. And again, we'll talk to Thomas Drake about that, and he'll tell us, though, no, they said that that was rule breaking when they came after him. But of course, that was persecution, not prosecution. They won't prosecute Hillary Clinton for this. Let's say the new stamps indicate that some of Clinton's emails from her time as the nation's most senior diplomat are filled with a type of information the U.S. government and the department's own regulations automatically deem as classified from the beginning, regardless of whether it is marked that way or not. Reuters found at least 30 emails from the State Department's own classified stamps that now identify them as so-called foreign government information. They say that sort of information, which the department says Clinton both sent and received in her emails, is the only kind that can be presumed classified, in part to protect national security and the integrity of diplomatic interactions, according to U.S. regulations examined by Reuters. And they quote J. William Leonard, a former director of the U.S. government's Information Security Oversight Office. He worked for both Bill Clinton and George H.W. Bush administrations, and he was director from 2002 to 2008. These are the people who oversee information security. And he says it is born classified. Hear that? It is born classified. It doesn't need to be marked. He says if a foreign minister just told the Secretary of State something in confidence, by U.S. rules, that is classified at the moment it goes into U.S. channels and into U.S. possession. He adds that for the State Department to say otherwise is, quote, blowing smoke. Yeah, precisely. So she's got some information here. Some of these emails are not only classified, but they were born that way because it's information that was given to the State Department from foreign leaders, and that is instantly classified even before it is marked that way. Now, they also say that State Department officials did nothing to protect Clinton emails after the attack. This is from McClatchy. They say security experts say the department should have taken immediate action after the hack of Clinton's confidant. This is Sidney Blumenthal. They say State Department says that it could not do anything because the hacked account was not a government employee's. Why was it not a government employee's? That was because Hillary Clinton had given it away. That begs the question, how did it get into a non-government employee's email? Well, it's because Hillary Clinton gave it to him. She gave it to Sidney Blumenthal. They say a March 2013 hack of longtime Clinton confidant Sidney Blumenthal happened because it occurred on a non-governmental computer system, and these were documents that had been given to him by Hillary Clinton. And the State Department did absolutely nothing. Well, stay with us when we come back. We're going to have Anthony Gucciardi and Dr. Group, and they're going to talk about some central keys to our mind and body health. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We're going to be going to Anthony Gucciardi and Dr. Group talking about ways that you can improve your health. And of course, if you don't have good health, there's not much that you can do to help your family, to make a change in this world. If you're going to be someone who wants to make things better or provide for your family, you need to have good health. That's why we offer the kind of products we do at InfoWarsLife.com to allow you to purify your water, to get the bad things out, and also to get supplements that will help you to get the nutrition that's been taken out of your food. But to tell you more about the central key to your mind and your body health, here's Anthony Gucciardi and Dr. Group.
I'm Anthony Gucciardi, sitting in for this segment of the InfoWars Nightly News, and I'm with Dr. Edward Group, and we're going to talk about the ways we can defend our bodies from the sustained attacks on our gut, on our mind, you name it. We're going to get into it right now. And first, I wanted to highlight this piece from Scientific American. Mental health may depend on creatures in the gut. They're talking about the microbiome and the good and bad bacteria in your gut and how it can really change your brain and the way it works. Studies suggest Wi-Fi exposure more dangerous to kids than previously thought. Cell phones are actually causing cancer, and we've got much more. Dr. Group, let's just get right into this right now. Thanks for joining us.
Well, thanks for having me on. I mean, we know that there's an attack on our mind, on our body, on the water supply, in the air with the geoengineering. And really what we want to talk about today is solutions. I say over and over again that everybody has a self-healing mechanism within their body, and it's really about first understanding the sources. I mean, we know that the air is polluted. So how do we breathe clean air? We put plants in our house. We know the food is contaminated. What do we do about that? We eat organic foods as best as we can. What about the water quality? We drink clean water. But we also need to clean the inside of our body. That's the outside environment. And we also need to focus on the internal environment. And that's why it's so important. And that's why we address some of the most essential things that people can take to prevent the degenerative diseases that we're seeing today, the mental health problems that we're seeing, like you said, which we now know and we've known for years and years and years are associated with the gut, because the biggest secret Big Pharma never wants you to find out is how important your gut and your liver are. And how easy it is to not only prevent disease, but eliminate a lot of the symptoms people are suffering from by just addressing and repairing the gut with good probiotics, with supplements like Oxy Powder, cleansing the liver with Liver Shield, and making sure you take some essential nutrients such as the iodine, which most people are deficient in. Most people are deficient in vitamin D, taking the winter sun. And not only that, the Super Male Vitality, all the products that the InfoWars Life store has available, which are all specifically designed to boost your immune system, increase your mental capacity, decrease the amount of toxins in your body, and ultimately let you live a healthier, non-dependent life so you're not having to depend on the pharmaceuticals and the medical doctors out there.
You know, one of the reasons I really wanted to talk to you about this is because you've been talking about gut health for, decades now, and how it all really, really ties in with the core of your health. And it's interesting to see, I mean, this is only from February of 2015, this year, from Scientific American. Mental health may depend on creatures in the gut. I remember reading a Live Science post, I guess, 3 or 4 years ago, when it was like, hey, it's very, very possible that the microbiome in our guts may actually have something to do with our health. And there were some comments on there and some, you know, retractors saying, no, that's absolutely absurd. It's totally crazy. And it's the same thing with cell phones. Here we have from the New York Times, it says, hold the phone, cell phone radiation can cause cancer. Sorry, it's New York Daily News. And how many times over the years have you been criticized for saying that you shouldn't speak on your cell phone for 10 hours a day, right? Holding it up next to your brain could be damaging because of the electromagnetic frequencies and the radiation. And I remember talking about cell phone dangers years ago and people saying, you're a conspiracy theorist, you're crazy. And it's the same thing over and over again. We find that when we talk about these things, we're criticized. And then years and years later, the mainstream media admits they're completely true. And talking about the gut health for a minute, they found, of course, we know that 50% of Americans will be diagnosed with a mental illness in their lifetime. They found that the gut bacteria is so central to the nerves that are going on that all the triggers in your brain can be messed up when there's bad bacteria. And there's actually neurons in your heart. So there's brain systems in your heart, in your gut, and all of it together can actually cause things like schizophrenia if they're out of whack. And it's really just a lack of nutrients in some ways that are causing this, a overgrowth of things like candida. Talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, what we have is all the chemicals in the food and the water supply and all the stuff that people are putting in their mouth are actually counterproductive to creating a biodome. And I mean, a biodome is something that is naturally formed that's in complete balance with the system. And the medical schools don't even teach about gut health, and that should be their main focus, because a good probiotic balance will produce the hormones that you need, produce the serotonin for the brain that you need. And that's also the reason why the appendix is there, because they say the brain of the body is actually in the gut. And I believe that after all the research that I've done. Also had to do research and figure out that the appendix is really what regulates most of the systems inside your body. And the appendix is still thought of as an unnecessary organ, according to medical science, when to me, it's one of the most important. It's also one of the most important methods of utilizing the proper balance in the gut, because if you do have the proper balance, the appendix will then relay that information to all the different systems. So it's amazing what I've seen just by cleansing the intestines. And by cleansing, I mean using something that's going to oxidize or turn all the solid, hard, compacted waste that's been accumulating in there for year after year after year into a liquid or a gas. And we use oxy powder for that to flush all that out and then put in all the good probiotics to help repair and build that biodome back up inside the gut. And it's amazing the amount of symptoms that go away once you have good gut health and then once you have good liver health as well.
Right, and getting back to mental health. So one of the things that I'm really passionate about covering over and over is the idea of an artificial state of mind that we've been put in over and over again by these contaminated junk food, and also, though, a lot of mental things that we do to ourselves. So I believe that we really should all be passionate, hungry, energetic people. But what happens is we put all this junk in our bodies, because it's not just about the lack of good bacteria in the gut. It's about the overgrowth of bad bacteria because of our bad eating decisions. And it reminds me of Roundup, Monsanto's Roundup, which is glyphosate-ridden. It's based off glyphosate, which they own the patent on. The World Health Organization recently did admit that glyphosate is a probable carcinogen, as in it's most likely causing cancer. And we eat this every single day, and we think about it for a minute. What is it doing? It's destroying our gut health. And all these toxins we decide to put in our body are destroying our gut health and allowing the bad things in our body to overtake them. And that's why I think InfoWars Life is all about creating products to fight the attack on our body specifically, because it really is an artificial attack. It's not like if we were living in the jungle thousands of years ago, eating fruits and berries and maybe hunting even, we would have this issue. What's happening is we're putting so much artificial crud in our bodies that we're having to compensate by getting super high quality, powerful minerals and nutrients that we may otherwise may have not needed. Am I wrong in that?
No, you're not. And a point that you brought up that hasn't been studied yet is the effect of electromagnetic radiation from the cell phones, from the smart meters, from all the cell phone towers, and also the effect of stress on the digestive tract. Now, stress completely constricts the digestive tract. And when you have the majority of the population out there, I personally think 100% of the population has digestive problems just because of the environment in which we live. There hasn't been studies on electromagnetic radiation and how that affects gut health, but I believe that it actually does. I mean, you can put probiotics in a tray and expose them to certain microwave frequencies or certain types of cell phone frequencies, and those might die. And it is. It's about that imbalance. It's if you take the good away and you have more negative and more bad growing in there, then the bad will take over. There's no balance. So that's why it's so important to utilize good nutrition, avoid all the toxic substances coming into your body on a daily basis. That's why people are becoming more educated every single day about probiotics, about intestinal cleansing. And it's something that everybody should do to prevent any further symptoms or prevent the progression of any type of disease condition.
And to add to that too, we think about the gut, and it's really just, it's the nerve signals to the brain that are getting messed up when all this is going on. So the electromagnetic radiation, I believe, would also have some power to that. So in closing though, hormones is another reason why a lot of us, I think, are out of whack. Wouldn't you say that in addition to the gut health and in addition to the negative toxins in the body is one of the key factors?
Absolutely. Well, most of the hormones that we're exposed to are coming through fragrances, phthalates. People are rubbing these lotions all over their skin, using toxic hair care products, but also drinking out of plastic bottles, eating canned foods. I mean, we do have a problem with endocrine disrupting chemicals out there, and that's affecting both males and females. So again, avoid that and cleanse your body on a regular basis to eliminate those.
All right, Dr. Group, thanks a lot for joining us. I'm Anthony Gucciardi sitting in for the InfoWars Nightly News tonight. It's essential to prepare yourself to be real. I'm super passionate about InfoWarsLife.com products because they're made to defend against these things. But overall, take your health into your own hands. Stick around. We've got a lot more coming up.
And again, that's Anthony Gucciardi and Dr. Group from last night's Nightly News. We're also going to have Alex Jones joining us in the next hour briefly with an update on situation with him. He's going to Toronto to speak up there, but he's had some passport issues, so he's going to give us an update on that. I'm not sure how that's going to affect his speech there. I think he's still going to be able to make it. He's going to give us an update on that, as well as talk about this divide and conquer as we see the people in Ferguson and St. Louis marching in the streets with the Black Lives Matter group chanting, "Let the war start," because that's precisely what this has been moving towards the entire time. Now, I want to go back to some of the news today. We were just talking about updates on Hillary Clinton, how some of the documents that are in her possession, even though some of them have been classified after the fact, some of these were conversations with foreign diplomats. Those are classified from the beginning. Even before they are marked classified, they are born classified, as experts have testified. That's one of the issues that concerns everybody. There's a lawsuit that is coming up now, and that the EFF, Electronic Freedom Foundation, has just had success in getting the first ever discovery in a bulk surveillance case. This is a federal judge in Los Angeles has given their client, Human Rights Watch, the go-ahead to take discovery from the government in their ongoing lawsuit, challenging the constitutionality of the DEA's bulk surveillance program. Did you hear that? It's the DEA, not the NSA, not the bulk surveillance to protect us from terrorists. This is the Drug Enforcement Agency, okay, the war on drugs. The war on drugs began all of this over-the-top destruction of our individual liberties, of the rule of law, the violation of people's privacy. That is now being extended into the war on terror. They say EFF is not aware of any other case where discovery has been allowed into a government mass surveillance program. They say the DEA relied only on an obscure administrative subpoena statute to obtain the records in bulk. That means that unlike the NSA's bulk surveillance program, there was no judicial involvement whatsoever. And I put that in quotes when I say judicial, because that, of course, is the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court created by the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act. They were supposed to be a safeguard against this very thing, against the bulk surveillance of American citizens without a specific warrant. The FISA Act came out of the Church Committee hearings back in the 1970s. They were concerned that the NSA as well as the CIA were watching Americans, and so they created this, and they said, we're going to have a court that's going to look at these sensitive issues, but it's not a real court. There's no adversarial relationship there. There's a single judge. And not only is he granting massive warrants, as Rand Paul has pointed out, you don't get a warrant for Mr. and Mrs. Verizon. You have to be specific about who you're going after, according to the Constitution. You have to say why, you have to say who, you have to say when and where. It has to be specific. You don't get these kind of broad warrantless searches that this has turned out to be. But it's not only the NSA doing it. They're not just using the FISA court to do this. Now you've got the DEA relying on an administrative subpoena. That's the way they got this information. And of course, it wasn't just them either. Guess what? It was multiple agencies that searched. This is involving everything they say from terrorism to drug trafficking to export violations. In other words, taxes. Anything, any excuse. This is not what the Constitution is about. They say it involved the DEA, the DHS, the FBI, and various unnamed agencies. They say they pushed back against this. The DEA said they submitted an additional four-paragraph declaration from one agent that said that the DEA's illegally collected records had been, quote, quarantined and purged. Well, the government, they say, was trying to sweep two decades worth of unconstitutional activity under the rug with a single four-paragraph declaration, but this particular judge pushed back against this in L.A. That's great, and great job, EFF, in getting that done. We need to have more of this. People need to understand the danger of dragnet surveillance, the danger of allowing the government to operate without any kind of law. That's what we're talking about. It's not even just a lack of oversight. It's a lack of law. The law is very clear. The law is very specific about this. And yet you have candidates like Chris Christie bragging about how he would do this, about how he caught terrorists. I'm not really sure what terrorists he caught. I mean, as a prosecutor, you don't even catch terrorists. You prosecute them. Other people catch them. He also lied about the fact in the debate. I don't know if you caught that when he was going back and forth with Rand Paul. We talked about it on the radio briefly. How he bragged about he started at on September the 11th as a prosecuting attorney for the federal government. No, that's not true. We produced the documents showing that George Bush did a press release in December saying that he would be appointed. And even on Christie's own biography on his website says that he began in 2002. But of course, that doesn't stop him from going over the top in a debate situation, putting himself out there as the savior of America with the Patriot Act. Look, we cannot buy security by giving up our freedom. You can't buy security by giving up liberty. That's what makes me so concerned about the wall that we're looking at. And of course, the Pope is coming, and he is going to be pushing for the rights of illegal immigrants. He was even going to come across the border to illustrate the point. We'll talk about that when we come back. Stay with us. We'll be right back. So I was mentioning just as we went to break, the Pope will be coming in September. One of the things he's going to be pushing is immigration. They say he would like to enter the United States if possible, crossing the Mexican border if he had the time. Perhaps he's not going to do that because he doesn't have the time. Nevertheless, he is going to be addressing Congress on September 24th, meeting 2 days later with immigrants and Hispanic families in Philadelphia's Independence Hall. A Democrat representative, Jim McGovern, out of Massachusetts, said, "I don't think anyone will have any doubt on where the church stands on immigration after the Pope visits the United States." Well, of course, yeah, because he's pushing globalist government. He's not talking to people about Christ. He's pushing globalism. That's what the climate change initiative that he has is about. That's why he is pushing for open borders. That's what this has become about. Now, let's talk about what's actually happening to some of the people. A lot of the people are saying, well, you know, Donald Trump, even though he's talking about immigration, he's getting a lot of support from Hispanics. Let's give you an idea why. Criminal aliens kidnapped and tortured illegal immigrants for ransom. Understand that? These are two illegal aliens from Mexico. They joined forces with human smugglers to kidnap and torture unsuspecting illegal immigrants being held at a stash house. Instead of charging the group, however, with taking hostages or with kidnapping or with torturing, what did the prosecutors do? They charged them with human smuggling, period. Not any of the violent crimes. We say over and over again, violent criminals, if they're illegal aliens, they're treated as if they're foreign diplomats, like they've got some kind of legal immunity, catch and release, or don't prosecute them for the violent crimes. And here they're committing the violent crimes against other Mexicans in this country. And yet our government still won't prosecute them for this. This is absolutely amazing. This is why I think a lot of people who are Hispanic are not happy with the open border situation. Even people who are just recently here are trying to get out of a country that has more violence, more deaths because of the drug wars that we've exported there than many of the countries where people are fleeing as refugees. We just had a report the last day or so from Paul Craig Roberts talking about the indifference in Europe to what was happening in so many different areas. They get excited about the violent immigrants who are coming into their country, but they don't understand that those immigrants are fleeing the wars that have been created by American and NATO foreign policy. And in the same way, we have a lot of these immigrants who are fleeing Central and South America, who are generally genuinely political refugees, are coming here because they're fleeing the violence of the drug wars that we have created there. Again, it's one of the root causes that we need to look at, that we need to address. And until we address those root causes, we are not going to do anything about the violence coming into our country. Now we have these violent gangs. Their basic fundamental business model is built on drug prohibition. That's what made them rich. That's what made El Chapo rich. And of course, he's got tunnels to get out of his prison, and they will have tunnels to get under any wall. As long as you have prohibition, you are going to be destroying the legal foundations of our country. You're going to be corrupting the police and the court systems, and you're going to be financing these kinds of criminal drug cartels, these gangs that have now extended their reach into Arizona, 70 miles, 100 miles into certain parts of Arizona. That is all based on drug prohibition. Adding more agents is not going to address that. It's simply going to make us live in more of a police state. Stay with us. We'll be right back. John Rappaport is going to be joining us in the next hour. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host today. Alex Jones is going to be joining us in this hour, and so is John Rappaport. We're going to have an update on where Alex is. He's going to be speaking in Toronto. He ran into some issues with his passport, but he is still going to be able to make that speaking engagement. He's also going to be joining us to talk about the divide and conquer strategies that we see playing out in the streets of Ferguson and St. Louis. We have an article up on Infowars.com. Black Lives Matter invades Central West End, busts out car lights, beats pedestrians. So we have the video of that, as well as them shouting, "It's time for war. Let the war start." That's what they're trying to do, is to create a race war, a divide and conquer. So we have our government, as they see economic situations deteriorating nationally and internationally, they're trying to create wars nationally and internationally at the same time. Now, in the last segment, we were talking about this case of a couple of illegal aliens torturing other illegal aliens. They were actually human smuggling. They were bringing people into the country, and that's all they were charged with. They weren't charged with any of the violent crimes because, of course, they're illegal aliens. So we don't really come after them to the full extent of the law. But look at this story coming out of Australia. There they have immigrants. They have immigrant processing center that's come under a lot of criticism for the conditions, the treatment of people there. It's the Nauru Immigrant Processing Center. And now they have testimony that points to the guards at this immigration center openly talking about waterboarding. They say they witnessed inmates coughing up water as they were leaving guarded tents. So there's stories that are now breaking that the Australian Immigration Center is actually torturing immigrants as they come in. How do we get to this point in the West? How do our societies get to the point where this type of thing can happen? Well, look at what's going on with Planned Parenthood. Look at what's going on with the removal of informed consent across the board. And that's what we're going to be talking to John Rappaport about when he joins us in the next segment. Throwing on the floor, shredding up all ideas of informed consent, of medical ethics. Of course, we even have a candidate who is a surgeon, Ben Carson, who supports mandatory vaccines. We had the Nuremberg Code to address that, to say that we're not going to experiment on people. We're not going to compel people to have medical treatments without their informed consent. That is the path to the kinds of abuses that we've seen at the Tuskegee Institute and the Nazi prison camps. We don't want that to happen as a society. But there's no respect anymore for the individual, for individual liberty, for ethics. And we can see this no place better than in these Planned Parenthood expose videos. This latest one that came out yesterday, to sum it up, this is a WND article. So you know there are times when the procedure is done that the heart is still beating. That's a quote from this latest video. That's from Ben Van Handel, the executive director of Novogenics Labs that works with Planned Parenthood to take organs from the bodies of infants terminated through abortion and resell them. So that's the Novogenics Lab. There's also a testimony from Holly O'Donnell, a former blood and tissue procurement technician for Stem Express. She says, you want to see something cool? She says, one of her supervisors told us. She said, she taps the heart and it starts beating. She says, I'm sitting here and I'm looking at this fetus and its heart is beating and I don't know what to think. Yeah, Hillary Clinton doesn't know what to think either. When she corrected Jeb Bush for using the term anchor babies, a lot of people said, well, maybe you should just call it a clump of anchor cells because you can't find anything wrong when they're taking babies who are alive with their hearts still beating. We have the GIF and the article and the video that you can see at InfoWars.com of a child on the table moving its arm, moving its leg, and they're going to dissect it alive. That's the state of our medical ethics. Stay with us when we come back. We're going to talk to John Rappaport about vaccines because that's a part of it as well. Joining us now is John Rappaport. We're going to go to him in just a moment. I want to let you know before we do that we have Super Male Vitality back at the InfoWars Life store. Super Male Vitality is back in stock at InfoWarsLife.com. It's a product that we've had out of stock now for several weeks. It's something that will help your body as it goes under hormonal attack. It's time to fight back, and you can do that very well with Super Male Vitality. Our Ultra Strength Super Male Vitality formula has hundreds of five-star reviews. Let me read one of those to you right now. This is from Ryan, the realtor in Spokane, Washington. He says, what a great product. I'm 41 years old. I feel like I'm 21 again. He says, this product helps me live a healthy, active lifestyle. I've lost 8 pounds in 3 weeks taking the product. Thank you. I would suggest that you go to our site, go to InfoWarsLife.com, take a look at the reviews. We have hundreds of them there for Super Male Vitality as well as other products. See what it's done for other people. See what it can do for you. Give it a try right now. It is back in stock again. You can find that at InfoWarsLife.com. Now, joining us now is John Rappaport. His website is No More Fake News. He's worked as a freelance investigative reporter for over 30 years. We carry a lot of his stories at InfoWars.com. One of them was back at the end of July talking about Congressman Bill Posey, who on July 29th, before Congress went on recess, was making a point about the CDC whistleblower, Bill Thompson, and saying, we've got all these documents, but nobody is paying attention to them. And at that point, he just starts throwing the documents in the trash can to make the point. Still, no mainstream media coverage of that. Joining us now is John Rappaport. Welcome, John.
Good to be here. Thanks.
Yeah, so tell us about this. We were just talking in the last break about the callousness of the American public to what's going on with the Planned Parenthood videos. We see in Australia, we've got guards there at an immigration camp that have been waterboarding immigrants that have fled into their country. I mean, we're seeing this kind of callousness towards the individual that is just absolutely amazing. And a big part of this, of course, is the mandatory vaccine movement that is going across the United States. And it's also an international movement to deny our fundamental human rights of informed consent.
You mentioned Bill Posey, Congressman, on July 29th. This was an incredible moment, really, if people would recognize it. He stood up on the floor of Congress and he read a statement from William Thompson, who is a longtime lead scientist at the Centers for Disease Control, the CDC, in which Thompson states, for the record, that in a 2004 study of the MMR vaccine, he and his colleagues cooked the data, fabricated the study, in order to give a free pass to the MMR vaccine and claim that it had no connection to autism, when of course it actually did. And the new revelation in the statement that Congressman Posey read, direct from whistleblower Thompson, was Thompson saying, my colleagues and I were in a room. We brought in these documents from the study that we were doing on the MMR vaccine. We looked through all the documents and we decided which ones to throw out. And we hauled a big garbage can into the room and we threw those documents away. We disposed of them. This is incredible. I mean, you know, this is, talk about fake science and destruction of the population because of hiding the connection of the vaccine to autism. And yet, barely a murmur from major media. Nothing.
Yeah, because all we hear from major, from mainstream media is that there is no connection to autism from vaccines. They keep repeating that over and over again because, of course, they get about 75% of their funding from pharmaceutical companies, and they don't want people to ask questions about the safety, let alone the efficacy of these vaccines. They have immunity because of a law that was passed back in 1986. They can't be sued because of damage that they do to people because of vaccines. Nobody asks why they needed to have that. Nobody asks why we would be mandated to have something that they have legal to take vaccines for which they have absolutely no legal responsibility if they damage people with those things.
I can tell you that behind this Thompson scandal, there's a lot more that is to be unearthed at the CDC that has to do with vaccines. And the failure of the Congress to investigate or the Department of Justice to make arrests and so on and so forth, which is, of course, typical, covers up that scandal. Because in the study that Thompson was talking about in 2004, two of his colleagues, who he states, you know, were throwing documents into the garbage can, two of his colleagues on that study, Colleen Boyle and Frank DiStefano, were not just authors of a study. They have major executive positions at the CDC in the area of vaccine safety. So their involvement in this throws scandal, conspiracy, cover-up over the entire CDC and everything they say about vaccines. Everything they say should be now considered as fraudulent.
Reading, John, from your article here, one of the things that you point out that William Posey read on the House floor, a statement from Dr. Thompson. He says, because I, as Dr. Thompson, assumed that destroying the documents was illegal and would violate both FOIA and Department of Justice requests, I kept hard copies of all the documents in my office and I retained all associated computer files. I believe we intentionally withheld controversial findings from the final draft of the pediatrics paper. So here we have someone who actually is kept this information instead of destroying it like Hillary Clinton or destroying it like the heads of the CDC. These were the people who were destroying those documents. He kept hard copies of it. And he talked to others about it. What is going to happen now at this point with Dr. Thompson? I'd heard at some point that he might testify before Congress. Do you know what the status of that is?
Yes, he's willing, he says, to testify before Congress, but that means that you've got to have a hearing. Somebody's got to arrange that, a committee hearing. And as of right now, there is no determination or willpower to put on such a hearing at which he would be, you know, the prime number one testifier. I mean, this would now take it into the public spotlight if they had a hearing. So from everything I'm hearing, there is no investigation plan, and therefore Thompson is going to stay silent because he has gone on the record and said that he will not speak with reporters. He'll only speak to government. That means we have nothing except the statements that have been read out by Congressman Posey, and we also have taped conversations of telephone calls between Thompson and Andrew Wakefield and Brian Hooker, in which Thompson even goes further in talking about the dangers of mercury in vaccines and how there's still mercury in vaccines. And this is extremely destructive to children's brains and so forth and so on. So we have all of this boiling below the surface. but no mainstream outlet, news outlet, is willing to cover it in the way it should be covered. And so there is no pressure on the Congress to hold a hearing.
Well, the mainstream media seems to have a vested interest in trying to cover this up as well. And of course, we have across the nation, we have state initiatives that would force us to take vaccines, even though we know a lot of these vaccines have questionable safety issues with them. And we don't know what's going to happen in the future. These vaccines can change, and we would still be required to take anything that that medical authorities or pharmaceutical companies decide to put on the list of mandatory things that we all have to take in order to participate in society, or we get relegated to a ghettoized existence. That's what's happening everywhere. And of course, there's also a national bill that has been proposed by someone in Congress that would do the same thing at a national level, because they've been turned back at several of the states. Texas turned it back, even though California passed that mandatory vaccination bill.
Yes, a couple things here. One is California right now is mandating the MMR vaccine, mm-hmm. which, as Thompson states, has been shown to have a connection to autism. So right now, the entire legislature of California and Governor Jerry Brown are acting directly to damage the brains of children by permitting that vaccine to be on the schedule and then mandating it for all public and private school children in California. I mean, that's a gigantic crime. The other thing is, and this came straight out of a New York Times article, and I wrote a piece about this a few weeks ago, the next generation of vaccines is going to be synthetic genes that are enclosed in viruses and injected into the body. Supposedly, underline that word, these genes would induce protection against various diseases. But the bottom line on this, and it's readily admitted by the researchers, is that injecting these synthetic genes into humans would permanently alter the DNA makeup of the human beings into which they're injected.
Yeah.
So this is what is on the horizon now. I mean, this is devastating news, and it's coming down the pipeline at us.
Well, of course, a lot of people will remember about a year and a half ago, there were announcements maybe 2 years ago that the pharmaceutical companies weren't really going to focus anymore on antibiotics. They were going to put all their focus on vaccines. And now this whole thing has gradually played out as they move from all these other drugs for which they have legal liability if they harm people. They're gradually moving everything, making every treatment a vaccine. And once they take away our informed consent, as you point out, they can put up all kinds of novel, experimental, and potentially extremely dangerous plagues into the system. Stay with us. We're going to be right back. We're talking to John Rappaport. We're going to be joined by a report from Alex Jones in the next segment. He's going to update us on his speaking engagement tomorrow in Toronto. That's why Alex is not here today. He's traveling on his way to Toronto to speak. He's going to update us on that, as well as he wanted to weigh in on this story coming out of St. Louis that we have up on InfoWars.com. Black Lives Matter mob invades central west end of St. Louis, busts out car lights, beats pedestrians, and chants, "We're ready for war." That's the kind of divide and conquer balkanization that we see being pushed by our government. We certainly understand that's one of the reasons why they are incentivizing the open borders, is to create another point of divide and conquer. Of course, John Rappaport has spoken about this. He's our guest this hour. He is an investigative journalist for over 30 years, and he has lectured extensively about who runs the world and what can we do about it. I want to talk to John now about his article, "The Program to Erase the Individual." We're talking about our government erasing our individual rights in terms of informed consent. But he pointed out in this article recently, he says the individual is now considered to be either A, a criminal by definition, or B, a member of a group defined solely by ethnicity, color, religion, gender. We're losing the concept of the individual, and that's why we're losing the concept of individual rights, isn't it, John?
Absolutely. As you mentioned, David, this is a complete overall operation. the purpose of which is to make people think that they have no power as individuals. They have no individuality. They have no uniqueness. They have no creativity. They have no rationality. That all that they are is what they are as part of a group, some group. And that group will always be pitted against other groups, as you say, divide and conquer. That's the strategy behind all of this. Chaos and then bringing in order. So in the process, what happens is the individual is ground down into thinking that he or she doesn't matter, has no, not only no rights, no freedom, no power, but nothing really to say. Nothing to contribute.
I think, John, what we're talking about, just as we're in the last segment, talking about the loss of informed consent, we see that being sold as herd immunity. And that's kind of a herd mentality to say, well, it really doesn't, the individual really doesn't matter in this vaccination debate because it's the group that matters. The individual means nothing. So we have this overriding group. And then within that, we've got all these different competing groups. And those are the only things that matter. The individual doesn't matter whatsoever.
Yeah. So you see, it's like a trap. You belong to this group or that group or this group or that group. And you pick your group and you form your allegiance. And then time passes and you forget that you're an individual. The whole process of history over the last three or four centuries can be viewed as the struggle between, you know, the rulers and individual freedom. And now this is all being thrown away. All of this is being cast aside as some kind of a delusion, a fantasy. Well, some people thought this was all about the individual, but really, it's all about the collective. And the government is going to lead us into a new era of peace and utopia and so forth, because we are now all together. We are now a collective. This is a propaganda, and it's diabolical. And the effect of it is that it makes many, many, many individuals forget their own selves, their own uniqueness, their own power, which is the purpose, or was the purpose, of all liberation struggles throughout history, and now has been turned around backwards 180 degrees.
And, you know, it's very easy for them to do that, because all they have to do, if they make the group the overriding concern of everyone, then even though everyone is feeling that they themselves are losing something, that they're being controlled, they're being repressed, they think, well, okay, but that doesn't matter because I'm just an individual. It's the group that matters. And I guess this is for the overall good. That's the way it's sold to everybody. John, when I look at this thing, the Black Lives Matter movement, and of course, we know that Soros has been funding the leaders of that. We've had documents that show that he's funding the leadership of that. They're focusing on just one group as if only their lives matter. And I understand that there's more police brutality problems in that community, but it seems to me they would understand that if they made this an individual problem that affected people of all races, they would see that they would have a solution. We'll talk about that more when we come back. Right after the break, we're going to have a report from Alex Jones updating us on where he is, the speech tomorrow, as well as weighing in on this divide and conquer strategy. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Alex Jones.
Ladies and gentlemen, Alex Jones here with some important breaking news and analysis. But first, I want to put a alert out to all the great folks that are set to hear me speak with George Norrie and others at the Queen Elizabeth Theater in Toronto, Canada tomorrow. My assistant, my nanny, went on vacation in Colorado. And when I'd gotten back from Europe a few weeks ago, covering what was happening there, I laid my passport on my desk and I said, please put this with the kids' passports in the safe. But she was putting some other documents in her purse to be taken to the mailbox. And she left it in there. So this morning, at about 7 a.m., I went to get my passport out, get dressed, pack my bag to fly out at 10 in the morning, and it wasn't there. Well, needless to say, I tore the house apart. She was asleep in Colorado, wouldn't answer the phone. So I'm basically shell-shocked from that, but finally found out that she had the passport, and she's apologizing profusely, and she's done a great job for a long time, so I forgive her. But let me tell you, that said, it's not a car wreck. Nobody's dead. Nobody's got cancer. So it's a great thing. And I was going to just call George Norrie and apologize and say, you know what? It's just too much. I don't think I can probably get the passport. She's out in the mountains by Vail camping. And I thought, you know what? There's thousands and thousands of people coming to hear me speak and hang out with George Norrie, whose events this is. Plus, I love George. So it's like the Blues Brothers or something. We're on a mission from God. I am flying to Denver. She's going to drive in with the passport. And then I'm going to land at like 3 o'clock in Toronto. And then that gives me 3 hours to get out of customs and get to the event and be part of it. That said, I've been around Europe, around the world, Latin America, you name it. I've never seen customs as bad as Canada. I mean, it was in the newspapers in 2006 at Bilderberg. George Norrie covered it. In fact, he helped go on the air and talk about it. And that's one reason they got me out. I was in there for 16 hours, 15 hours of them saying, we're going to arrest you. How dare you come cover Bilderberg? Canadians are great people, but their customs are well known to be really harassing. And I hear American customs harasses Canadians now when they're clearly Canadian citizens. So it's just ridiculous. It's how Ron Paul says these walls are built to keep us in, not to keep the illegals out. I was watching all the foreigners, you name it, people that didn't even have proper visas just come into Canada. But if you clearly are there on business or are legitimate, they harass you. That's why we need to go after the incentives of hiring some of these folks. And we need to go after the incentives of the corporations that are actually lobbying for more cheap labor to drive down wages. But I'm about to go get on an airplane and fly to Denver. And they got direct flights. It's the biggest airport in the U.S. into Toronto. There's no flights this evening that I could get in on by the time I get to Denver, or I'd go in tonight. So no, there's a pucker factor for George Norrie and Tom Danhauser and the rest of his great crew because they really put on a professional show. But I'm going to be there. Knock on wood. These direct flights are rarely late, so there shouldn't be a problem. We'll see what's going to happen there in Toronto. Now, let's shift gears out of this. Cross our fingers. and you can find out more at George Norrie Live, his website. Let's shift gears into the really, really serious news now, and then I'll throw it back to David Knight and the rest of the great InfoWars.com crew here in Austin, Texas. I'm still in Austin. Let's go to InfoWars.com and look at some of these videos that we're going to be talking about and discussing, and then David can play some of these videos for you today. Video, cop slams old man to the concrete for singing in public. This is like the cop we saw 2 weeks ago that walks over with a gun because the guy's filming in public and basically threatens him. This is what's wrong with police. This is what happens in third world countries and in totalitarian countries, authoritarian systems. And the fact that some departments are hiring people and then protecting them when they act like this is a serious crisis. Because then total confidence is lost in local government, which is exactly what the globalists want. So things devolve locally, and then all power goes to the central government. It weakens the nation. It allows tyranny to come to the front even faster. And the good news is, I saw an article just a few days ago showing the numbers, record amounts of cops being indicted, record amounts being fired when they attack people for no reason or shoot people for no reason. So the truth is, law enforcement is trying to become peace officers again, and the good people in there really do get it. And because of the exposure of the police state that we've spearheaded and others have spearheaded, it's being reversed now. That's why George Soros and others and Clinton are coming in trying to hype up all these thug mobs to go out and attack police and others to delegitimize serious demonstrators that want reform and don't want globalization, federalization of police. And then when thugs go out and attack cops for no reason, that legitimizes the police state and the globalists win. This video is powerful. Now let me go over some more of these headlines that are really, really important that I was just mentioning. Look at these crowds and watch this video that's up on InfoWars.com from Gateway Pundit. Black Lives Matter mob invades Central West Inn, bust out car lights, beats up pedestrians because they're white. And a lot of the thugs that are out there are white thugs. They're just criminals, black, white, Hispanic, who want to put hoods on their heads and go out and attack people and engage in criminal activity because the police raided somebody's house and they pulled a gun on them, reportedly. Meanwhile, a little black girl, the same day in the town, got shot by black on black, and it's a non-issue because it doesn't feed into the narrative of race war that the globalists are pushing. And there's a powerful rant by this lady that I'm going to play on the show after I leave. Epic rant goes viral. Police brutality? How about black brutality? 90% or more, depending on the state, 87, 93, it varies. The national average is about 90% of crime against blacks is black on black. Everybody knows that. And it's just ignored when it happens. Why is it hyped up when it's white on black? Why, when cops shoot a white person in a questionable thing, it's not even a news item. Even the New York Times admits that. But it is when a black person gets killed. It's because this is racial identity politics. It's all about the perception that somebody's under attack. And then people start acting aggressively and acting angry and upset, and that plays into the narrative. But this lady really, really, really lays it all out, and I want to salute her for what she's exposed. Now, finally, speaking of this balkanization, this divide and conquer, this liberation theology, Pope Francis has encouraged the illegal immigration of the U.S., says those opposed to it should seek God's forgiveness, close quote. I think the Vatican, one of the richest institutions in the world, in Vatican City in Rome then, should open its doors to anyone that wants to climb over the gates and climb over its big walls and climb over its big fences. And we can show you some of that footage we shot there 2 weeks ago. And that unlimited amounts, billions of people worldwide want wealth. They should just have people come in and live in the treasury and live in the papal throne rooms and just in the giant facility and just fill the church. That's what churches are supposed to be for. Get rid of all the armed guards around it. And stop the sin of having a wall. Stop the sin of having security. Stop the sin of having all that wealth, those helicopters, and the Swiss Guard. And stop the sin of your announcement that you have diplomatic immunity and are above the law and are the total sovereign on the earth and have the keys to heaven and hell. I thought Christ had those. Oh, but you say he gave them to you. Okay, whatever. Then it's time, Mr. So-called communist that wants global carbon taxes and world government, it's time for you to open up your borders to all the Vatican resources, all the Vatican facilities around the world, some of the biggest landowners on the planet. But no, you're a big, fat, stinking hypocrite, and you make me sick. And I know a lot of good Catholic people. Now, I've never bashed Catholics because I think the fruits of a lot of what the Catholics have done have been good. But let me tell you, there's no doubt with what you're doing. Where are you on the abortion? Where are you on abortion gate? Where are you on all the babies being dissected? Oh, you told us. You said over and over again, stop obsessing on abortion. It's sick. And you're a hypocrite. And you are absolutely anathema to what the Bible says and what it stands for. But you get your liberation theology that Jesus was a communist, Jesus was a socialist. It's sickening. So give up your wealth. Open up all your facilities around the world to the poor. You say you are your own sovereign nation and that you choose who can come in and who can go. You have no right as a sovereign nation, just like America doesn't, to have borders. We will let people in and you will pay for it. And if 10 times that come in and you can't pay for it, doesn't matter. You will pay for it. You'll give everybody what you've got. In fact, under your direction, Catholics worldwide, even if they're poor, should give everything on. You know, they have a way to just whoever climbs over their fence, including their children, because we do give our children up to have them dissected, their body parts sold. Why don't you speak about veterans being put on no-treat death list and the real evils going on? No, you just sit there and pose, just like Rachel Maddow, just like Bill Clinton, just like Barack Obama, and act like you're a humanitarian. When you're a hardcore social engineer for the megabanks and the Vatican's been totally taken over by blackmail. It's even the London Guardian for all the pedophilia. And you are the globalist guy they've put in there now to complete the takeover of the Vatican and to turn it into a total engine of world government and total domination. And it's shameful. And now he's going to come here the 24th of September and lecture Congress about opening our borders. They've said they are. How sick, a foreign leader of a foreign sovereign government who keeps its borders completely tight and controlled and is totally greedy and hands out almost no aid. Worse than the Clinton Foundation, and then you're going to lecture us. Why don't you go back to your gated armored fortress, you hypocrite, and get down on your knees to all those idols and all that loot you've got in there. Looks like a Las Vegas was scooped up and vomited into there. Alex Jones signing off for InfoWars.com. I'm Canada bound. but from the West, from Denver, going to get my passport. How wacky is that? Infowars.com. If you're watching or listening, you are the resistance.
Okay, so Alex is having quite a day. He's got to go to Denver to get his passport before he can go to Toronto, but he will be in Toronto to speak tomorrow. So all those people who are expecting to see him, he will still be there. He will go to the ends of the earth to make that date. We're also talking to John Rappaport. We have John Rappaport on the line with us now, and we were talking to him about efforts to erase the individual. And again, quoting from what he's written, he says, individual is now considered to either be a criminal by definition or a member of a group defined by ethnicity, color, religion, that sort of thing. Going back to that first definition, a criminal by definition, that's what the government considers individuals to be. Remember the debate, the first Fox debate, where there was a back and forth between Chris Christie and Rand Paul? And Chris Christie said, we have to look at everybody's information. We have to do dragnet surveillance of all the American people. Otherwise, how will we know that you're not a terrorist? You understand what's behind that. In Chris Christie's mind, in the mind of those who run the American government right now, everyone is a criminal, and you have to prove that you're innocent. I mean, that's the whole point of what we go through at the TSA all the time, isn't it, John?
Yes, absolutely. You know, I have to chip in on something that Alex was talking about, just writing a piece on that now about the Vatican. The Vatican thrives, as the Roman Church has thrived for centuries, in conditions of extreme crisis, poverty, chaos. They know that. That's where they live. That's where they themselves prosper the most.
Yes.
If they can turn history back to that, where you have whole nations overcome and unable to deal with, say, floods of immigrants moving in and so forth and other many other situations of dire crisis, that's what they want. All of statements of the Pope to the contrary are complete baloney. There's nothing humanitarian about this at all, because part of the globalist takeover is reducing nations to a state of utter dependence, chaos, helplessness, and poverty. And that's where the church has always shown. That's where they come to the fore. They know how to exist in the middle of chaos. This is when people, the population is so desperate that they grasp at any straws, and the Roman church is there waiting for them. That's what they do. That's how they operate. That's what they're all about. It's in times of prosperity and great optimism that the church recedes. And so they will do anything in their power to keep that from happening. And that's their whole objective. That's what they're doing here.
Of course, so, that's what is behind the open borders as well, is that socialist agenda to take down the country, take it down economically. I mean, we had social scientists, Cloward and Piven, saying that we have to step up the welfare state. We have to increase it exponentially so we can take the economy down. Then people will turn to us. We can remake the society in the way that we want to do it. And part of what the Pope is wanting to do is to set up a global governance. That's what the climate change agenda that he has there is about as well.
Absolutely. And again, to what Alex was saying, the church has untold trillions of dollars worth of assets. So where are they allowing immigration on an unlimited basis within their own church's borders? I'm not just talking about little sanctuaries here and there and individual priests that genuinely want to help the poor. I'm talking about a global program to say, here are all of our assets. We have trillions upon trillions of dollars worth of art and objects and manuscripts and so forth. And we're going to sell all of this off because we're going to open up great swaths of land that we control and welcome in the poor. That's not happening at all. The Pope is doing none of that. That's not on their agenda. He just wants everybody else to do that, to throw the world into chaos, because that's when the Roman Church triumphs. That's what they're all about.
Absolutely. And when we look at the burgeoning police state that's happening here, in that article that I talked about earlier in the show, we are the government tactics for taking down the police state. In that article, we read from over-criminalization and surveillance to militarized police and private prisons, it's money that drives a police state. Of course it's money that drives a police state. And as we have this increasingly violent police state, as we have the prohibition state that's being driven by the war on drugs, people increasingly and futilely, John, turn to the government to protect them. That's why I think 70% of the people are supporting a wall at the border, thinking that somehow building a medieval wall is going to protect them from criminals when they don't address the root causes of what's happening with us. And of course, the root causes are it makes money for businesses to import workers into this country. They can lower their wages. It serves the agenda of the socialist government that wants to make everybody dependent on them. It makes them more powerful. And of course, it's going to be something that a lot of companies are going to make a lot of money running what's going to really be a high-tech control grid, like I was talking about earlier in the program, what we can see already happening in Israel.
Yes, absolutely. And, you know, for a long time, we've heard this kind of slogan or motto, piece of propaganda, that the prosperous nations were going to raise up the poor in poverty-stricken nations. And that was an idea, but it was never real. The whole idea was to just absolutely exploit, take over, and decimate those countries, and then allow immigration to flow anywhere it flows. Because the real objective, which would have been a good idea, to raise up people in the countries where they live and to get rid of local tin pot dictators.
Hang on right there. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We're talking to John Rappaport. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We're talking to John Rappaport of NoMoreFakeNews.com. In 1996, John started the Great Boycott against eight corporate chemical giants, Monsanto, Dow, DuPont, Bayer, and others. Of course, that still continues, but he understands that at the bottom of all of this is the economics. What is taking away the rights of the individual is also serving the bottom line of the corporations. We see that in the agendas that they're pushing for mandatory vaccines. We've seen it in the mandatory insurance policies that we're forced to buy through Obamacare. We're going to go back to John in just one moment. Before we do, I just want to let you know about a sale that we have for a limited time at InfoWarsLife.com. We have 30% off Silver Bullet. And if you buy two, you get two free. So that's 50% off with a buy two, get two free if you want to go that route. It's a good time to stock up on it. We have it in stock. It's always going to be there for you. It doesn't expire. So while it's on sale, it's a good time to add it to your preparedness package. It's a 30 parts per million concentration of silver, colloidal silver. It's in a base of pure deionized water. That's why so many people get it for their preparedness package, and you can get that right now, 30% off a single bottle, or you can get two bottles and get two free. That's at InfoWarsLife.com. Well, John, as we've been talking about the individual and the erasing of the individual, and I was talking about the dangers of having a massive new police force to handle the problem of open borders without recognizing that we're incentivizing the people to come in here. We're not going to be able to stop them by force if we continue to incentivize them. If the government does it, if the businesses do it, we're going to continue to have people come in here no matter how much of a police state we set up. I think it's interesting looking back at what's happened in Israel. I think it's kind of a beta test for this. Hewlett Packard is a good example of, like, these chemical companies that you're talking about, the kind of crony capitalism that we see behind this kind of police state. When they pass their national security laws, when they pass their biometric tests for people coming and going into the country, when they set up all of these walls that run throughout the occupied territories, they did that in the dead of night. They didn't let the press cover it. They didn't have any discussion about it. They did it in the dead of night, just as we see the indefinite detention being passed here in the dead of night. That's the way these things always roll out, but there's always corporations making money behind that. When we look at the process and how it ran out, they had all these different bids out for different companies to run this biometric tracking. And over again, the only one that made it through any of the processes was Hewlett-Packard. And at one point, the Ministry of Finance said, this is corrupt. We're going to start this whole process over again. They did it and still got the same result. So when you've got an inside track, you're going to come out on top. And that's really what's driving a lot of this, is the crony capitalism. But of course, we lose our freedom in the process.
Sure. Look at who's getting the contracts for the private prisons. Look who's making money off the so-called war on drugs. as a major reason for keeping the borders open. I mean, you're talking about the Sinaloa drug cartel in Mexico. You're talking about gangs in the United States who are basically mules for drugs from coming up through Mexico, Sinaloa. You have the case of Niebla in Chicago, a major player in the Sinaloa cartel, whose lawyer had evidence that the cartel had signed an agreement with the DEA, the government of the United States, to allow clean drug routes for heroin and cocaine to come up in the United States all the way to Chicago, central hub. This is all business. It's business and money.
Oh, yeah. El Chapo even had his own private window at HSBC where he could launder his money. That's how bad it is. Thank you so much for joining us, John Rapoport. And again, you can find his work at nomorefakenews.com. That's it for our news broadcast. Join us tonight for the InfoWars Nightly News at 7 Central.